Hello folks, welcome to the Wikipedia world and I am Abhinay Gupta. Today we will start with a very interesting and fresh topic, which is in short known as the SARFAESI Act 2002. If you go by the detail of this name, it is the Securitization and Reconstruction of Financial Asset and Enforcement of the Security Interest Act 2002. I know that the name of the act is a little scary. It goes as a bouncer, it's difficult to understand what the act wants to say. And I have had reviews of lot many students who have complained that this is one act for which the terminologies are very difficult to understand. Right? What happens in the SARFAESI Act is just out of our reach. But my dear friends, let me tell you one thing, that this is actually one of the most simplest chapter. One of the most simple chapter in your entire curriculum. You just need to know the base on which the entire chapter is created. There is one single flow of the entire system. Once you understand that, and there are basic terminologies, you need to feel them. You need to understand what they mean. And then the entire act is very smooth. Because the terminologies are very difficult and they're confusing. Right? If you go to mug them up and to understand them by the bare act or the text. But once you get the feeling of what they mean, once you get an understanding, in a layman's term, it becomes very easy for you. So today I'll make an attempt to give you the basic of the chapter, the entire flow of the securitization and the reconstruction of the financial asset, right? And also the enforcement of the security interest. From where and what flows and what are the meaning of the terminologies. It's not about the definition that I'm talking about. I won't go by the text and explain you and give you the definitions, but yeah, I will give you the basic meaning of what it means in the layman's term, right? So let us begin with the chapter. All we need to see today is the flow chart of what happens and how it flows. So we basically have four components in the entire chapter, starting with the obligor. Now again, this word sounds very peculiar. Right, it is, what does an obligor mean? My dear friends, just keep in mind, obligor is nobody but that person who comes to the bank for a loan. Right? They are the borrower or the guarantor for that borrower. Right? Those people are known as the obligor. If you go to a loan to a bank to take a loan and you take your friend along as a guarantor, then both of you will be considered to be an obligor for this act. Right? Next component in this flowchart will be the bank, because when we are talking about the securitization and reconstruction of financial asset, that financial asset is basically the debtor of the bank, right? So the bank gives out loan, and when it is not able to recover its loan, that is the time when the securitization and reconstruction company stands in the frame, right? So next component we have is the securitization and reconstruction company, and the fourth and the last component is the qualified institutional buyers, right? So now, these are the four components that you basically need to understand. Right? The debtors, the borrowers are known as the obligor, and the bank is known as the obligator, like who is giving away the loan. Right? So first thing is we need to understand the transactional relationship between the bank and the obligor. Right? Consider yourself to be an obligor, and then there's a bank. Right? So what happens is the bank gives you some financial assistance, which is the loan that you have desired. You go to a bank and ask, let us not consider you. Mr. X goes to the bank and asks the bank, I want a loan for rupees 5 crores. Will the bank give him a loan? No. What the bank needs in return is the documentation. The bank needs some security, some asset, some guarantors. Not just a person going away to the bank and asking, please give me 5 crore rupees. Bank won't give it. Right? Bank would give them the financial assistance only when they give them the financial asset in return. Right? Financial asset is the secure asset, the property. Right? So financial assets basically are these obligors. These obligors are the financial asset from the bank's point of view. Right? Debtors are the assets. If you talk in terms of your accountancy, debtors are your assets. So for the bank's point of view, the obligors are known as the financial asset. They are, right? The financial. It is not the person. It is not the debtor. It is the debt that the bank gives. The bank has advanced debt, the bank has advanced loan and taken the property in exchange. So this is the financial asset for the bank. and the money and the loan amount that the bank gives to them is the financial assistance. Right? So you go to the bank, you take the money, you give a security. Right? So that is the financial assistance you're taking and the financial asset you're giving to the bank. Right? Now, for example, you have taken a loan for a period of 1 year. And at the end of 1 year, Mr. X is not able to pay the loan back. What does the bank do? Bank will send a notice to Mr. X. Mr. X still denies to pay. But the bank lodges logs in a case against Mr. X. Right? It goes to the court and files a petition that we need our money back from Mr. X. He has taken 5 crore rupees from us and has not returned it. Now, what will the court do? The court will call Mr. X and ask him. The court will inquire as to what is the reason behind it. Why are you not giving him the money? And then Mr. X, in most of the situations, says, the court, my honor, my lord, I am bankrupt. I don't have money with me. Right? And these are the things going on. So I'm not able to repay at the moment, but I will do it in near future. And the bank will say, okay, this is the interest that will be levied on you. This is a little bit of penalty and please do it as soon as possible. And the case is closed. Next, again, the person, Mr. X, is not paying the loan. Again, bank goes to them. Now, the bank has an identity in the market, right? So the bank cannot go to Mr. X and forcefully take the money from him or chase him out of his house and sell his house. No, the bank cannot do that. All that the bank can do is go to the court, right? And once the bank goes to that person to get the money, the person goes to the court and gets a stay order that he is not able to pay. He will take his time. It's a stay order. So at that point of time, the bank is under a very critical situation. 5 crore rupees is gone. It's a stay order from the court. Neither the bank has the asset, the financial asset that was given, the house. The bank cannot sell it because he has a stay order on that. And the money is already with the obligor. So what is remaining with the bank is nothing. The bank is at a loss. The bank is losing interest on that money. He is not able to spend that money. He is not able to lend that money. Right? We have seen the Banking Regulation Act. So over there, the main purpose of the banking is stopped again because the bank doesn't have the money. So this is when the bank takes the help from the securitization and reconstruction company. Right? So what is securitization and reconstruction? Securitization is taking that financial asset from the bank, right? Securing that financial asset for the bank. That is securitization, right? And reconstruction is to get that money out from the obligor. I'm talking in the layman's term. We are not going by the definition of the chapter, right? It is just in the layman term to make it easy and simple for you to understand, right? Securitization is you take the asset from the bank and secure it, and reconstruction is to get it repaid from the obligor, right? Now, why will the securitization company come to help the bank? Obviously, it needs something in return. Now, what does that securitization and reconstruction company need? Obviously, it's the money. So the securitization company approaches the bank. Okay, this is the asset you have and you have a stay order on it. Great. And the person has taken, Mr. X has taken 5 crore rupees from you and is not repaying. You are going at a loss. There is a chance he won't be repaying it at all and you will not be able to do anything. So let us get into a deal. Give me that financial asset for rupees 3 crores. I'll give you 3 crores. I'll pay you 3 crores. And that financial asset will be mine. And I will get the money out from the obligor. And whatever comes out, it's mine. So that is the kind of deal. So the bank gets to settle it for 3 crores. It's at a loss of 2 crores. And this 2 crore is actually the profit for the securitization company if it is able to get the money out from the obligor. If it is able to reconstruct that asset. Right? So what does the bank do is, once they get into an agreement, the bank gives the financial asset to the securitization company, right? It hands it over to them, and in return, the securitization and reconstruction company gives the settlement amount to the bank. And now the responsibility of the bank is over, the loan for the bank is over, the financial asset has shifted to securitization company, and the financial assistance that the bank had given to the obligor has returned at a diminishing value from the securitization company. Right, so over here, till now, the bank is at a net loss of rupees 2 crores, right? And now the securitization company can go ahead to the obligor, chase him out of the house and sell the house. Yeah, these are those kind of people, right? They'll get the bulldozer and then the house is gone. The obligor won't be able to do anything and even the court will not interfere. Securitization and reconstruction company are such company that are present in the market to reconstruct the asset, to reconstruct the loan amount. and when they go ahead to do their work, there is no court intervention. So now the obligor can't go to the court and say, I want a stay order, this guy is coming with a bulldozer from on my house. No, he can't do that. Right? The securitization and reconstruction company, the people will go, they'll chase him out of his house and sell the house and get the money back. And if after that also the money, for example, if they sell the house and the value is already degraded and they get, for example, 4 crores, now they are at a loss of 1 crore. Right? So at this point of time, they can approach the debt recovery tribunal for assistance. And they'll say, this man has taken 5 crore loan from us and we have sold his house, we have earned 4 crores, but still 1 crore is at stake. So the debt recovery tribunal will take further action against the obligor and will get the money out. And but if you remember, but when the securitization company comes to the obligor and chases him out of the house, the obligor has no right to approach the debt recovery tribunal. Right? So these people have that kind of a power, and that is why they come into the scene, because the bank is not able to do this. Bank has certain liabilities, certain responsibilities. Right? It has an image in the market. But the securitization company are basically meant for this purpose. Right? And now the point is, from where does the securitization company gets the money to pay to the bank, the settlement amount, the 3 crore that we're talking about? For that, they approach the qualified institutional buyers. They are the basic investors in the entire flow. Right? They go to them, they prepare a scheme. Okay, this is the asset that we are taking. This is how we are planning to reconstruct it. And whatever amount we get, this will be your share, this will be your profit. Right? They prepare an entire scheme. Right, and then approach the qualified institutional buyer and give them a security receipt. And this receipt is not compulsory to be registered. We'll just give them a security receipt. Okay, this is the receipt of your amount that you have paid to us. And we will maintain it in a separate bank account and reconstruct the asset and pay you your money back with the profit that we have decided to share. Right, and the qualified institutional buyer in exchange gives them the finance. Okay, you take the money and that finance goes to the bank and the bank is settled. So this is the entire flow, and by this I guess it is clear with you that what is a reconstruction and securitization and reconstruction company, what is their use, what do they do in the market, right? And their powers and their actions and the entire procedure, entire flow, the legal things, we'll do in the provisions of the act. We'll see the various sections, we'll understand it in detail, but this is in layman's terms what is going to happen. Right? So I have tried to create a base for you so that you understand and you have a set of mind to flow into the direction of the chapter, to flow into the direction of the act. Right? Because unless and until you understand what securitization and reconstruction of financial asset means, you cannot commence with the act. So I hope this class was very useful for you. Right? And in the coming lectures, we will complete the provisions of the act, the other sections. And mark my words, this is one of the most easiest chapters. And we have already done the Banking Regulation Act, if you see in my previous lectures. So, Banking Regulation Act and the SARFAESI Act, these two acts are clubbed as per your practice manual and study material. Right? If you see questions in your practice manual, you have questions based on both the acts combined. Combined means in the same chapter you have the questions, and the same is for your study material too. And if you look at the weightage in the examination, it is on an average of 8 marks. Right? You have very limited and very easy sections in the Banking Act and very limited and very easy sections in the SARFAESI Act. So there's no reason why you leave this chapter or take it lightly. It is both of these chapters are very important. On a combination, you get a question of on an average 8 marks in your examination, and 8 marks in CA final is a very crucial amount. Right? So make sure you go through these acts very precisely. And in the end of the lecture, in the end of the chapter, I will also discuss the important sections, the questions, the kind of questions asked in examinations, and what are the past year questions that have been asked. Right? So I'll try and make an attempt to make it very simple for you and useful. Right? So until then, this is Abhinav Gupta signing off. Stay tuned for the coming lectures. Thank you. Bye-bye.